ESPN's Laughter Permitted Podcast. This is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is Julie Foudy.
And Lin Ozawi.
With ESPN's Laughter Permitted Podcast. How do you hear us?
Julie and Lin, it is incredible to have this opportunity to speak with you. I have you loud and clear, and welcome to the International Space Station.
Yes, we are beyond excited to do this interview with you, Nicole.
It is such an honor to speak with you. Thank you for this opportunity.
Let's just first establish what an absolute baller you are. Former soccer player at the Naval Academy. Shout out to my former teammate and your coach, Karen Gabera. F-18 fighter pilot, 47 combat missions to Afghanistan and Iraq. And now, hanging out in space as an astronaut. So, we would like to bow to you. We bow. You can't see this, but we are bowing to you. We always, Nicole, set the scene for the first thing we do on the podcast. So, what you're doing, where you're at. If you would be so kind, can you set our most epic scene set ever?
Awesome. Yes. Well, I'm on board the International Space Station, and we are flying 250 miles above our beautiful planet Earth at 17,500 miles per hour. So we make a lap around our planet every 90 minutes. It's pretty incredible. This is a floating laboratory. We have 7 crew members on board as part of Expedition 68. And we're doing a ton of science on board, some maintenance and upgrades to the space station, and really having an incredible time.
Oh my goodness. Flying around the Earth at 90 minutes to get around it. That is crazy. Let's start with the fact that you're also literally making history right now as the first Native American woman to go to space. What is that honor meant to you? And as you said, you've been in the space station and you've been there quite a while, almost 5 months. What do you do all day? I want to hear about this day.
Absolutely. So it's definitely an honor to represent Native Americans in space. And I definitely feel that that's a great responsibility. I think it's important that we share our story and our journey with the younger generation so that hopefully when they aspire to reach their goals and dreams in life, they can look and see people, hopefully role models that they can give them some of that courage and some of that fortitude to continue forward. On board the space station, the days are actually quite busy. We're doing some really cool science up here in microgravity, everything from growing dwarf tomatoes to literally 3D printing human cells. It's a pretty amazing and very rewarding work that goes on. There's a lot of maintenance. On board, we had the opportunity, I did personally, to go out the door and do 2 spacewalks during this expedition with my crewmate Koichi, and we helped to install some equipment to upgrade the solar arrays on the space station. Personally, it's just incredible. I mean, I'm in microgravity just floating around. I feel like a little kid most of the time. Every time I float through a module, I can't help but pretend like I'm Superwoman, you know, like floating by and playing with water and food in microgravity. And we have a module on the bottom of space station, so the belly of it looking at planet Earth, that's made of windows. So it's 7 windows. And that, you know, if you're having a tough day, all you've got to do is go down to the cupola and take a look at our beautiful planet. It just takes your breath away. It's the most incredible thing I've ever seen.
Nicole, I feel like a little kid talking with you right now. This is just the opportunity of a lifetime. And I'm going to send a big question out into the universe to you. With the unique perspective you have right now on Earth, what is a message you would like to send back to us here on Earth and have us consider in our daily lives?
Yes, that is that's a tough question because there's so many things that are important that we focus on in life. But for me, the first feeling that I get when I'm in the cupola and I look at our beautiful planet is just this feeling of awe and amazement. Because especially during the day, when you look out into the blackness of space, it is the blackest of black, black emptiness you've ever seen. And then as your eyes move towards the planet, you can start to pick up the atmosphere, and you see this little gray turn into a light blue, turn into a deep blue, but it's still this thin layer that's protecting our planet from the vacuum of space, and it's really the only thing that's keeping us alive. And then you look at our planet and the beautiful blue of the ocean and the white of the clouds, and you'll pass over far distant lands and countries in a matter of minutes. You don't see any boundaries. You don't see any divisions. You just see this little fragile planet in the black blackness of space. So I would ask people on a daily basis to think about that. You're a small part of this marble in space. And how do you fit into this entire world? We are all on this planet together as human beings. So how can we come together as that species to take care of each other and to take care of our planet? It's the only one we have.
My goodness, the perspective you're going to have forever after this trip, which will have changed so much of what you do and how you think, I'm sure. Nicole, it's time for Most Pressing Questions, International Space Station Edition. Are you ready for this? It's very intense.
I'm ready.
What is the most fun thing you've done in space?
The most fun thing, you're going to make me pick just one. That's really difficult, really difficult.
Okay, our microphone just hangs.
Only because you're not here to tell me no. Okay, on the light side of things, the most fun thing to do is to play with water. Because water behaves so differently in microgravity. You know, water just falls to the ground on Earth, but if you squirt water out of a bag in space, it just forms this ball, like this sphere. And because of the surface tension, it sticks together. And my crewmates and I the other day played with water, and we put some drops of food coloring in it. And it's amazing just to see that move around. It's like this foreign object. You put your hand in it, and it just sticks to your hand and covers your hand like some alien goo. And so that's really entertaining. But I would have to say, from a, you know, like a work professional standpoint, absolutely the most incredible thing is going outside the skin of the space station on a spacewalk. Just you, your spacesuit, and that visor between you and the vacuum of space. That was the most challenging thing I've ever done mentally and physically, and also the most rewarding experience of my life.
Oh my gosh. How long are you out there on a spacewalk?
So the first one, we were out for 7 hours and 40 minutes. And then on the second one, we were out for about 6.5 hours. So it's people describe it kind of like a marathon. It is, I'd say, a marathon plus. From the physical aspects, you're in the vacuum of space. So the spacesuit is pressurized to 4.3 PSI. And so you're working against that pressure of that suit each time you squeeze your hands to hold on to a handrail or move your arms. But it's amazing how mentally fatiguing it is, because every move that you make, every action you take, you're thinking through very closely, because you could certainly damage the space station and kill yourself should you do something in air. And so you're constantly on the highest alert that you've ever been to make sure you really don't screw it up.
Do you have an athlete mindset when you're out on your spacewalk?
Oh my goodness, absolutely, absolutely. So our coach at the Naval Academy, Karen Gabera, she always talked about this mental toughness, right? The game, yes, the game can be physical, the game can be technical, but the majority of the game is this mental toughness. And that is so true in soccer. It's so true, I think, in any sport that you play. And it's very true throughout life, and specifically on a spacewalk. It's that ability to stay focused, even though you're mentally fatigued, even though you're physically fatigued, even though things may not be going as you had planned, or maybe you screwed something up and now, you know what, you've got 6 hours left, so you better get your stuff together and figure it out. I remember one moment on the spacewalk, being at one end of the space station, and the space station is the size of a football field, so I'm pretty much in one end zone, and my next task is to go translate, which means hand over hand climb, to the other end zone. And it's about 5 hours into the spacewalk. And I know they're going to say, okay, hey, you're ready for this, right? You need to be mentally and physically ready to do that. And And I didn't even have to think about it because I had the mental toughness that Karen taught me when I was a young kid that I've grown throughout my life to know I'm prepared, I'm mentally ready to go, and even though this is going to be challenging, we're going to be successful in making that happen. And I think that you could take that to on a spacewalk, and you can take that to your family life, and you could take that to your job back on Earth, just as you do to the sports field.
Nicole, not that I think this is an essential act in life, but how do you shower, given that water forms into, as you mentioned, a bubble?
Yes, absolutely no showering. It's doesn't happen in space.
That's,
I know that's kind of
that's
gross.
Pure heaven.
That's the one thing I think
pure heaven.
So when we were playing with that ball of water, we actually smashed our face into the ball of water, which is something that I've always wanted to do. Of course, you know, as a kid, you want to do that, and now I still want to do that. So you smash your face into this ball of water, and it clings to your face, and it doesn't go anywhere. And so now you have this film of water on your face, and you want to take a breath, and you go to kind of wipe it away, but it doesn't go anywhere. And so you have to take a towel to wipe it off. You could literally drown in like a quarter cup of water. So no showers, but we do have these, we call them waffle towels. They're towels that have soap in them. You get them wet and you can kind of do a sponge bath, which is the really, you feel kind of clean, but I guess my family will be the judge of that when I get back to Earth and they give me a hug for the first time, whether or not I'm stinky or not.
whether the waffle towels are working or not. We do a segment on this podcast at the end called High, Low, Cheer. And it's the high of your career, the low of your career, and the cheer is for someone who's helped you along the way. So can you start with the high of your career?
I think the high of my career, definitely leaving Kennedy Space Center on top of a rocket and launching to space. That was absolutely the high.
Do you know, by the way, that our entire 1999 Women's World Cup winning team was watching you do that together?
That's awesome. No, I did not know that. Thank you so much for being a part of the journey. That's super cool.
We had an entire text thread. We were like, this is amazing. Karen's on it. Gabera, it was fantastic. We watched it all on YouTube, on NASA's YouTube channel. It was so great.
That is awesome. Thank you.
And the low of your career, Nicole?
I'd say there's been multiple times. It's those challenging times. I remember being challenged in flight school where, you know, I went out on a flight and I didn't do well and I downed that flight, meaning essentially you fail that flight. I remember the first time going to the aircraft carrier and trying to land on the deck of an aircraft carrier and I didn't do the greatest, you know. I remember going through my initial spacewalk training at NASA and not doing well on some of those early runs and just feeling so deflated and so just down. And it's those times though that you learn to rise above that. You learn to figure out, okay, what can I do better next time? Let's pick ourselves back up. And you get to a point, I think, in life where those feelings are no longer, certainly they're uncomfortable and they suck, but they're not these unknowns anymore. You know, okay, I've had something like this before, I felt this before, and I'm gonna overcome it, and I'm gonna figure out a better way that next time I do that, I'm gonna be successful. And so I don't think I could pick just one. I think there's many, and I think a lot of people have many of those moments in life.
Yeah, and what we often find on this podcast is it's those lows that bring you to the highs, isn't it? And finally, your cheer for someone who's helped you along the way.
I'm going to have to give a cheer to my husband, Travis, and my son, Jack. You know, they're back on Earth holding down the fort, taking care of everything while I'm up here living my dream, executing my dream. And really, it's their love and support that's so important. I really, truly think nobody can do anything on this Earth on their own, right? They need their team, their family, their support network, whatever that is, those people that support you and pick you up. And if it wasn't really for the support of my husband, the day that I told him, hey, I think it's, you know, NASA's accepting applications, but it's crazy. I don't, you know, I'm pregnant. We're about to have a kid. I don't think we can do this. And he looked at me like I was crazy and said, you have to apply.
Yes,
if you never
Travis.
Apply, you're never going to make it.
Yes,
and there's never a good time. So thank you, Travis. And thank you, Jack. Your love and support means the world to me.
We only have a couple minutes left. So before we let you go, can you please show us some type of trick you can do? What is the coolest trick you've learned in zero gravity?
Well, there's a lot of tricks, certainly just floating upside down. I didn't bring any water, but if I had water, I could. But here you can see my here's my superwoman. Ready?
Oh!
Oh, wait, do you just spend all day doing that? Forget the experiments. We don't need to do science experiments. Let's just float all day.
The ground watches us closely, and if we're messing around too much, they'll give us a call and tell us to get back to work.
Oh, do they? They scold you if you start playing and floating too much. I love how you don't even hold the mic. It just floats right there, right? I saw that. Look at you, can just toss it between hands. That's so good.
It's incredible up here. It's so much fun. So someday, maybe you can come to space. Commercial space travel is picking up, so you might have the opportunity soon.
You know what I was thinking? When you come back to Earth, do you think Julie and I can get a ride with you in an F-18?
Well, at NASA, we don't have F-18s, but I'm pretty sure that we could work with the Navy and Marine Corps and get you up in an F-18. At least we could ask. If you never ask, you're never gonna have a chance, right?
I feel like, Colonel Mann, you'll know someone that knows someone that knows someone that can get us on one of them. I just want to say, when we get back to Earth, please, can we do a 5-month interview with you? I know you've been on the road, so to say, for 5 months, but we want to do like a whole podcast season of interviews with you to talk about, I mean, the fact that you're actually trying to make human organs in space just blows my mind. There's so many there's so many questions we haven't been able to get to. So I just wanted to thank you for your service. Thank you for being an inspiration. Thank you for continually showing us all what's possible by breaking barriers in everything you've been able to do in your career day by day.
Thank you so much, Julie and Lynn. It was really a privilege to have a chance to chat with you today. And I look forward to chatting with you back on planet Earth.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Come home safely. Thanks for all you do. Thanks, Nicole. Superwoman out of here.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes our event.
Thank you to all participants from ESPN's Laughter Permitted podcast. Station, we are now resuming operational audio communications.